Lover, I know you're weary as a tide from the night. Lover, come to the kitchen floor, tiles are cold, so am I. So take from me.
Hi, how are you? So in a continuation of the chapter 2, in previous lecture we finished looking at the phylogeny. And the key point of this modern phylogeny is DNA sequence comparison, the legitimacy of DNA sequence comparison in determining the relative evolutionary relationship. What's the kind of a take-home message? Now, here the taxonomy is, although taxonomy on the surface it looks very similar to the work of phylogeny, but this is something that strictly only the organization, classification, not necessarily. So in taxonomy you don't really have to, the evolution, any information about evolution, not necessarily, you do not really need to. So this is not an absolute requirement. You can if you want to. Well, it's nice to have any some information, relative information in taxonomy. However, you're not really required to include this. And so, and the another way of calling taxonomy, some people call this taxonomy the systematics. And in that particular occasion, when people call this taxonomy the systematics, usually they try to, as much as possible, they try to incorporate this aspect, the phylogeny aspect, as a tool. The beginning of this taxonomy actually was made possible by one renowned biologist. Back then he was actually known as a naturalist rather than more specifically biologist. He invented this Swedish scientist Carl Linnaeus, but his actual Swedish name we use more familiarly, we call it as a Carl Linnaeus. So it's called the binomial nomenclature system. Binomial means using two naming system. So he attempted to identify and then group according to the a specific rule he thought it was reasonable. And so his mission was identify and classify all the living present at the present living organisms. So inevitably, so in grouping, it involves some form of a hierarchical these categories, because you have to create some big group, and then within that big group you have to create several subgroups. That's the natural way of grouping and classification. So like you can easily understand what's going on just once if you take a visit to the library. Then if you try to find any specific book you want to check out, right? So according to that binomial nomenclature system, it goes from top to bottom, the very bottom, from the biggest group to the smallest group. It goes from kingdom, phylum, family, class, order, genus, species. I'm not saying that you need to memorize any of this, but simply I present this all naming from top to bottom to give you what the idea of this binomial nomenclature system. So here, this, with this whole hierarchical naming system, actually in an identification of one very specific species, then these two names, actual species name plus one top, the name just one level above, the name of that genus to which this particular species belongs. Both of this information are used to designate and identify a specific organism. So for example, this the panther's scientific name of this panther is Panthera pardus, but here it so it should be this pardus is actually the name of this specific organism, panther, and the Panthera is the group, a larger group which encompass include several highly related the panther-like leopards, like cats. Okay, so then no wonder why if you go up and up like this way, then here another bigger group, which is a Felidae actually, which means all those cats, okay? The family. And then if you go up, some older, bigger group called the Carnivora. Carnivora means any animal that is meat-eating animals. And if you go the larger group, which to which this all this carnivora group belong, then you will encounter the much larger group, including all those mammals, class Mammalia. Mammalia means all these breastfeeding animals. Okay, and then finally, if you go up one notch above, then phylum Chorera. Chorera means any animal having this spine. Okay, right. So this way, you classify all those animals. All those animals are including one particular big group, the kingdom animal, kingdom Animalia. Then what are the kingdoms then can you think of? Kingdom animal and kingdom plant and kingdom fungi, right? So all those molds and yeast and mushrooms. And what else? We just left out one more eukaryote, kingdom protist. Usually we call them as a kingdom protista instead of a kingdom protist, but either way, actually, it makes sense. So those four kingdoms, protist, plant, planta, and fungi, and animal, all these are the eukaryotic kingdom. And plus one more kingdom here, kingdom Monera, which means the bacteria. So all together, this formerly famous five kingdom was the way of grouping all those living organisms that are five kingdoms. But nowadays, with the clear recognition of there are two distinct groups in the bacteria, the prokaryotes, so rather than these five kingdoms, what we have here is three domains. And domain eukarya, eukaryotes, and domain bacteria, as we have seen briefly in previous lecture. And one other big group is domain archaea, which is archaebacteria. But these two groups are the prokaryotes. So you can imagine that these, each of these two groups is a huge actually, and diverse, and they are having diverse members of And another, the third group is Eukarya, and within this Eukarya, there are four actually kingdoms, like kingdom animal, kingdom plant, kingdom fungi, and the kingdom protist. So this is the more popular way of classification in the later on in these days. But regardless, so in getting back to this binomial nomenclature system, the reason why it is called the binomial nomenclature is simply because it's when pointing out one specific particular organism or species, we use such two naming system of one type of genus name and the species category like this. And you have to use this as a rule, as an always trying to italicize the genus species. It's called the scientific name. So, and sometimes, and a lot of times actually, the name of a genus is shortened, it's abbreviated in one big capital letter like this. So us, we human, the scientific name of human is a Homo sapiens, but sometimes, a lot of times actually, the Homo, the genus name Homo, it is shortened into the H and H sapiens. And this one, canis lupus, which is dog and wolf, they are the separate group. They belong to a different genus and lupus, although both is Homo sapiens and canis lupus, dog and wolves meet in this big group of Coreta. Both of them are the back containing, spine containing animal, just like that. And look at this, a chimpanzee is, although I keep emphasizing that chimpanzee is the closest relative of us human. However, even this chimpanzee, the genus name chimpanzee, is different from Homo, us. So they even belong to a different genus. But then that is the group, those animals are the closest related, evolutionarily speaking, in this. In other words, we are the only member of the genus Homo. Whatever happened to all other friends or relatives or cousins, other members of this Homo's, they all unfortunately no longer exist. They got all extinct. Still the mystery why they all had to go away, and we just leaving us only alone. But anyway, that's the thing. So the species, the reason actually the Carl Linné back then, the reason for him to invent this binomial nomenclature system to identify each different organism was he truly believed the creationism. So he firmly believed that all those organisms are just product of God's creation. So that he believed it was his duty, humble duty, to identify each of them. So that, what is going on? Jeez. And that's the reason he began those. But unfortunately later, the scientists, the people realized that there were all those unknown species, unknown organisms, plants and animals, unearthed, dug in the form of fossils, like including dinosaur and many other extinct animals and plants. So then they wondered what was going on. If those were the God's creation, why those suddenly all of them disappeared? And does that mean some new species actually emerged that in the middle of all this, along with the history of our Earth? And that's actually one of the key contributing factor that scientists had another new idea about this origin of all these living things in the form of evolution. But anyway, So here the point is the species, the number of species existing are so many, diverse, that even with this scientific naming system and then relentless efforts by those scientists, a subgroup of scientists who devoted their lives in simple identification, classification, but it's only the estimated number. We didn't get there yet. Only less than 10% of these estimated or the different species living today on Earth have been identified. That means that reflect such a huge diversity of different living things. And more importantly, this fluctuation is numbers. This is not something that exists stably, but even today, a lot of those existing species keep disappearing, and you never know, actually, maybe here somewhere on Earth, a new species emerged. We just couldn't sense or detect any such event if they were ever. So this extinction and the history of Earth showed that with, not to mention so many different small-scale extinctions, but such major, huge extinctions, which I mean by that, what I mean by that is major extinction is more than 70 or 75% of the existing all different species disappeared, vanished. That's we call the major extinction, the mass extinction, another way. Having recorded during the history of the evolution, like so, on this map, this time scale at present, all these asterisks point out such a major extinction. On the y-axis is only simply to indicate the sea level for some reason. Maybe just if there was any correlations between the sea level and the major extinction, we don't know. But anyway, so this the latest such mass extinction event, as we looked at in this chapter, that was caused by the collision from the outer space, that big asteroid which wiped out all the living dinosaurs, and so that opened the new opportunities for us, the mammals, so that accelerated the evolution of the human beings likewise too. Okay. And more importantly, so in other words, this another mass extinction will definitely will come. It's just a matter of time, when, right? But another thing that most of the scientists agree on is they don't know when the next extinction, next extinction will come ever. However, majority of the scientists agree on that whenever it happens, it will be on us. That the next mass extinction will be caused by us. We will be the one responsible, sorry. And actually, there I indicate that recent news reports I read, was within next, the past 50 years, like last 50 years, oh, surprising, about 60, more than 60% of the mammals, not only all different the species, but 60% of these mammals got underwent an extinction in this short during this short period of time. It's very scary. And who else can we blame on? The global warming, maybe, but majority of them was environmental, the disruption caused by man-made activity. And this book, The Sixth Extinction, was written by one of the biologists, the ecologist, who was particularly interested in the conservation, the global conservation. So she wrote about a lot of those, the brief history of the species diversity in the past and the upcoming, the risk, and then actual tangible the danger that we ultimately will result in this the next extinction, and title is the sixth extinction. So if you have any time, then it will be a very good the reading materials for your own that Kyoyang sake. With that, so finishing all those the major aspects of a macro evolution, and here the next section is about the discussion that's about a brief history or the milestones of the debate between the evolutionist and the creationist. However, instead of looking at all these each details, I will briefly just zip through this, simply only living in one trendy the message about what is it, what is this all about? Why always there have been some conflict between this idea of so one part from the scientists, in particular the biologist, they believe the idea of evolution is a true fact, and the other side of this, those who are more particular sector of the religion, the Christianity, who are more serious about this, and they simply this idea is very dangerous, so that it should not be taught in school is probably the main reason of this turmoil and conflict. And so, as one of those who stands from one particular side in this position, and I represent the whole view of this evolution, why I have already emphasized this several times, and to the biologist and this field of science, the biology, and probably perhaps then other the more broad area of this natural science as well. This evolution, without this evolution as a principle, everything collapses. So there's no point of thinking and trying to pursue any academic or scientific or even practical aspect of this related field of biology without the basis, the fundamental basis of this idea, the philosophy and principle of evolution. So it is not simple, remote, isolated idea which can may be true or may not be true, but without recognizing this evolution as a true fact, although a little details about how it went along could be maybe not 100% accurate. However, overall, the fundamental framework of this evolution as an idea is just the fact we have to. All those who are involved in this business of the biology, they have to assume this as a fact. So that is not as a matter of any point of the discussion. But that is something that cannot be easily reconciled by the other opposite side of this debate. That's why it has been always some conflict, and you win some and you lose some type of seesawing has been going on. At the center of this conflict and the debate, three main points which have been criticized by the creationist sector, which recently have facelift the name the once formerly they represent themselves as a so-called creationism, but it's been changed into something called intelligent design. So here in the underneath of this intelligent design, which means although a really small aspect may not be as written as exactly literally written as in the Holy Bible, but the basic idea of the origin, all these living things are actually the not the result of the spontaneous generations, and after all, afterwards the process of evolution, but something that result of actual the sophisticated and great design by God. So along with that, what they have criticized the three major points as a flaws of evolution is one, it doesn't fit to this the law of a second, the second law of thermodynamics, which stated it is impossible to have anything have a more complex form, to create more complex form spontaneously without any intervention from simple organism, I mean simple material, not the organisms, right? So which directly predict the idea of a chemical evolution. However, as we went over in a certain specific circumstances, it is not always impossible to have, just because you created the complex cell from inorganic material spontaneously, that doesn't mean that you have just violated the second law of thermodynamics. Why? It's because, let's say you have from scattered inorganic material somehow, with any luck, we have created some cell like this complex organization. So obviously here the result is a decreased entropy. So you just violated the second law of entropy, because so always this entropy will go to the direction of the increasing. So how can you do this? But remember, this is a local, this is only a local event. If you create this decreased entropy here, so to do so, you have to provide what? If you want to create this situation, then you have to provide the energy. But then, according to the first law of thermodynamics, there is no way you simply create the energy, but you have to take the energy from somebody else. Okay? That bigger procedure of bringing in this energy procedure, actually created by doing so, you are creating this huge entropy increase. So overall, if you do this, then overall still the entropy of the entire universe the entropy. Once again, just increase a little bit because of this event. So there's no point. I mean, it is a moot point. No, you did not. You have not violated anything at all about the second law of thermodynamics just because you created a cell from nothing spontaneously without asking for the help of God. And the incompleteness of a fossil record is another the issue, in that If that is the case, then if all these living organisms were generated from some any kind of intermediate form of what that common ancestor, then how come you don't get to see any all those intermediate forms as a fossil record? Because they are the ones that that represent all of those the common ancestors in the past. However, then they simply neglected the fact that how difficult it is to obtain any fossil. Because any theoretically possible the previous living form, only a very fraction of them can remain as a, in the form of a fossil. So that is that reflect only a very small portion of the lucky ones. Besides, there was the earlier days of this fossil digging, but nowadays, more and more and more and more fossil records are being discovered continuously. So this so-called incompleteness has been filled with towards more complete direction. And finally, that is the most laughable argument about this is the estimation of their actual time, geological time, is incorrect. That's what creationists maintain. So instead of this something like a 4 billion years of the Earth's age, actual age of the Earth is only at most something like 10,000 years or so. Why are they maintaining sticking with this idea? Because if the Earth's age is that long enough, that something like 4 billion years, then maybe there might have been actually the enough time for the process of evolution to take place according to this current idea of this evolution by natural science, the natural selection. However, if the age of Earth is only something like 10,000 years at most, just like the what just as the Bible described, then there's no way this whole diversification will be accomplished within such a short period of time. But that is something like it's not worth to argue against about this, because that is a fact that the age of this Earth as long as something like 3 or 4 billion years is just a fact. No one can argue about this, but they do still. From a different angle, at the same time, if you consider how imperfect of the knowledge that we have currently in modern science, the biology in particular, then also we can easily recognize that the idea of this evolution, no matter how fundamental and significant for the existence of the biology as a science, but still at the same time it should be really, really merely something that not at all near to any perfection or complete idea. Think about this. What we know in this field of natural science are all the result of all those efforts that set up by the physics, actually. So all physics try to explain all those phenomena in the form of laws, and so like laws of relativity and laws of gravity and the nature of the materials. And then within this limit, the boundary of physics, then it comes chemistry. So although we do have such a great extent of knowledge in chemistry regarding many, many different small molecules and how they interact and what kind of new materials can be created and then also can be destroyed, etc. But this is that cannot go beyond of the this limit of the physics. Then not to mention of this life science, biology, is no matter how complex looking they are, but this is only seems a game, actually game played within the rule of this physics and chemistry. And hopefully you notice why this the initial the boundaries of physics was drawn very tiny in space, because that means how little we know in physics. So in these days, with such a great advancement in physics in many, many different areas of physics, but still there are huge amount of so many different things that we don't know, and there is no way we can even, we have no idea about how to approach this, all those different phenomena in the universe. Physicists cannot even attempt to understand or explain it. So then this idea of revolution, how little frivolous thing, it, which at any moment it can be totally thrown away as a total garbage in the future. We never know. And that actually that's a dynamic characteristic of any science. Any established principle nowadays can be thrown away as a incorrect, totally incorrect in any given days, is the original presumed stance in any area of science. And beyond this boundary of science lies so many different sectors of what human brain can reckon with, including religions. So that's why in the first place religion and biology cannot have any common ground in the first place. So that's what we stand in, and that's the reason why we have such a useless conflict between this, which totally should ignore about. When we are in this biology, let's just mind in our own rules of moving along with the biology. That's all I can say. Time flies, so that it's been already 3 years, I guess, when Stephen Hawking, the one of the greatest mind and physicist, passed away. And then when he was alive, he was quoted as saying this, so we are merely a little advanced form of apes, but we can understand the universe, and that makes us very special. I'm not sure how, I mean, literally speaking, how accurate this was, because upon his news of his passed away, I look up the Korean newspaper, and then it was the title written in Korean. So I literally directly translated on my own, so it could be a little something inaccurate, not 100% accurate, but anyway, this whole basic idea was there. So which what he meant by this sentence was so understanding something, knowing something correctly. So from the side of as a physicist understanding universe correctly is even though those apes and humans sharing the common ancestor in along the lineage of evolution, but that little things makes us very special, and is his what he is saying. To expand this type of the acknowledging something correctly and being aware of something, making something special. How about this? So that actually can be extended into this side. So if we also understand our origin correctly, like where we come from, which means we are simply sharing all those lineages along with not only with the apes but all the other seemingly little the worthless creatures, does that make you feel more superior and arrogant? But I personally think no, to the contrary, that makes us very humble, because our special, the special version of us, like human being, which in many aspects we seems to be very, very enjoying many different things. We are having this luxury of a life compared with the other our relatives, but that makes us very humble, because with this, it is just a matter of taking a little different steps in the course of the evolution, then we are enjoying this with all these advantages in controlling all our surroundings. But the others are just simply the less lucky ones, and also make us very compassionate, right? Because we can feel for them, those who are having the same origin with us, rather than something totally isolated, and then there is a really, really big gap. We are the one, the chosen, and they are the one, actually their purposes are to serve us. That is not the case. We hopefully we all we are all agree on at least on this one. Okay, and finally, this being humble and being compassionate is actually I believe, as I learned from my previous personal experience in Christianity, was actually the two most fundamental and significant virtue in Christianity, I think. Okay, so finally, in this section of the chapter, we are briefly going to look at the human's origin and evolution. So it's been said that chimpanzee and human share the common ancestor like something like 4 to 6 million years ago. MYA simply indicate. Million years ago, and then with that, so the common ancestor between the chimpanzees and all these different ones here, the human. So all this group which split from the common lineage between the apes, the chimpanzee, and other monkeys, and this human-like the beings, these are called hominin. Human and other. And unfortunately, among these hominins, we are the only sole survivors, and the others, all the rest, have just gone extinction. So it's been believed to have this type of path. In the beginning, one specific type of hominin called Australopithecus and Homo habilis, somewhere Erectus and Neanderthals and Homo sapiens. And in between there are many, many little branches and something that I just intentionally omit. But these are the main, the main existing at the time, the hominins representing the path of this human evolution in the course of. So along with that, some little trends also could be noticed, like starting from the earlier form of these humans, so Australopithecus, and toward us, a little general trends of increasing this brain size, which probably is highly correlated with the intellectual activity and ability. And actually, the reason why Homo habilis is named Homo habilis is the habilis means it's tools. So these are the ones started using a little, although primitive, a little tools, which also make them different from the other, the rest of other chimpanzee like apes. And Homo erectus here at this point now 100% fully, they just stand up right. So the bipedal way of standing up, and instead of using four legs and walking or moving, only using these two legs and standing up and walking and running is that has been actually one of the very significant in terms of our the human evolution, because with this bipedalism now you can increase greatly the distance that you can walk in a day. So yeah, maybe cheetahs and lions they can run much faster than us, but speaking of this the how far you can go, this perseverance wise, this type of anatomy allows us to have such a long walk, which is advantageous to at least just little advantages to the migrations, I think. This Neanderthals and was this Homo sapiens, the reason in this figure, these two groups of humans depicted as a three naming system instead of the binomial nomenclature that I have just introduced in this section, was Homo sapiens. Both of them are actually technically can be recognized as the same Homo sapiens, because they can integrate. Later on I will give you a little story about this, the integrating between Neanderthals and Homo sapiens us. So just like we designate dogs as a canis lupus familiaris, one little, the third epithet and last. So same thing is applied in naming these two groups of humans. So Homo sapiens neanderthalensis versus Homo sapiens sapiens. So that's sometimes how we distinguish between this Neanderthals and the modern human Homo sapiens. So the not only this cranial size increase and this bipedalism, also other little anatomical features also follows with this transition from earlier form of more primitive form of humans to the modern, more modern form of humans like this. And in this, so here once already, let's say if you have so many different types of fossils discovered, and then the one immediate question come up is, how do you know actually which one's first and which one's the others? Yeah, in some lucky cases, actually the ones that are found in the more older form of the soils obviously represent the older form of these remains, than the new ones. However, in reality, things may not be as straightforward as this, as we hope. But then, when you actually assign the relative distance among different our ancestral form of humans, and also the other ones, even though you can try some this comparative morphology and the anatomy, that may not serve always as perfect to resolve this issue. And once again, we have to call for the help of this DNA sequence comparison. And in this occasion of comparing, determining the human relationship, evolutionary human relation of the deceased and no longer existing one and the presently living one, as well as those who are living in these days but living on a different area on Earth, like, and I'm talking about the different races. And a lot of times actually you wonder, how are we actually, what's the relationship, relative relationship among different races? And then in that occasions, this comparison, in particular, this DNA sequence of mitochondria and the human, the Y chromosome DNA sequences has been very helpful. So, in two major occasions, including in determining, in trying to decipher the origin of modern humans, and also, like I said, the relationship among nowadays human different races, like Koreans, us, more close to the Mongolians, or more close to Japanese, or to Chinese, well, you never know. So then let's find out by comparing the sequence differences on average populations. Why only these two different particular? How about simply randomly picking any of the DNA of your chromosome, but only in particular, especially why it's mitochondrial DNA? And why among all those 23 different chromosomes, why in particular this Y chromosome? Yeah, of course, there is a reason why. First, speaking of this mitochondrial DNA, if you didn't know, actually, this mitochondria, little organelle in the eukaryotic cell, but interestingly, so in here in nucleus, we do have our nuclear chromosome, have 23 different chromosomes exist. I'm talking about human. So 23 different kinds of chromosome. So we have another set of 23 different kinds. So all together, we do have a total number of 46 chromosomes, right? This 23 and another 23 set represent from different the paternal and maternal origin. That's why. So having these two sets of chromosome, do you still remember what we call this type of organization in our genome? Is called a diploid. Having two sets of chromosome, but in the other area of, by the way, this is a nucleus, right? So this is a nucleus. How do you call the rest of the area? Other than nucleus. So all the rest of the area inside of the cell we call that a cytoplasm. Yes. Okay. So in this cytoplasm, little organelle. Actually, we have so many such organelle in a single cell, although I draw only one. This is mitochondria. In eukaryotic cell. In prokaryotic cell, they don't have such things. But inside of mitochondria, actually, surprisingly, they do have this their own DNA, mitochondrial DNA. The mitochondrial DNA looks different. It's much smaller than the chromosome in chromosomal DNA in the nucleus. But also, their appearance, this mitochondrial DNA is is circular, like the circular DNA, as opposed to linear chromosome, linear DNA in linear. Spelling, always the spelling problem. Linear. And this is a circular in mitochondrial DNA. Actually, later on I will just bring it up in the next chapter. This is the characteristic of all this prokaryotic DNA. Prokaryotic DNA. So all circular DNA, whereas all the eukaryotic DNA is just a linear form. And this prokaryotic DNA circular form exists inside of the mitochondria, surprisingly, like this. So this mitochondrial DNA is although just like eukaryotic DNA, they are also organized as a double-strand DNA, double helix, that famous double helical structure of DNA, but their whole shape is closed, being donut-like shape. And usually a single mitochondria, actually single mitochondria is called the mitochondrion. Single mitochondrion has several of such exact copy of replica of circular DNA. And another thing is, this DNA, unlike the nuclear DNA, which is diploid here, which means having two sets of each of the different chromosomes, chromosome number one, and two of the chromosome number two, but here this is only the haploid, which means that do not have such the another sets. Here, this diploid means the chromosome sets are like having homologous chromosome partner. Then we call it a diploid, something like, hey, if you are a chromosome number one, then there must be another chromosome number one. We call it chromosome number one prime, because one came from father, one came from mother. So then this type of organization pattern we call the diploid, because between number one and number one prime, these two chromosomes, they are homologous chromosome. Okay, so in diploid, in human cell, the diploidity, the human cells, the reason why human cells chromosomes are diploid is because for each different 23 chromosome, they do have, each of them has homologous chromosome. That's why it is called diploid. However, in the case of this haploid, they do not have any such partner. So you are the only one representing your own unique the genome organization. So that's the difference in between mitochondrial DNA and the nuclear DNA. This mitochondrial DNA is a haploid. That means do not have any homologous chromosome. And their shape is circular form, and also their DNA, a whole amount of DNA in length is very tiny compared with the counterpart of the nucleus. Why, getting back to this original point of discussion, why mitochondrial DNA in such DNA comparison pursuing the origin of human and relationship? Because one key reason why don't they are preferred in this occasion is they do not show this feature of so-called recombination. They don't have anything just like a recombination. What is recombination is this nuclear DNA being diploid, which means homologs having this homologous partner. Every different chromosome undergoes this recombination before producing these gametes. Okay. Remember, in the mode of a DNA, cell division is different in normal body cell, which we'll talk. Normal body cell is called the somatic cell. But another type of cell we carry is gametes. Which means sex cell, like sperm and egg, okay. Or egg, an egg or whatever. So these gametes are haploid. All these somatic cells are diploid. In order to produce this gamete, in order to produce a sperm or egg through one particular type of a cell division mode, you have to play a little trick. Okay. You cannot simply double up your chromosome and during the cell division preparation and then divide into half. Here, one very important thing is you have to ensure that every different chromosome set in the resulting daughter gamete, you do not lose anything, because the gamete, the amount of a chromosome is going to be reduced into half. So you have to be very careful. You don't have any extra. So if you lose, if you miss in taking one particular chromosome in forming one particular type of a gamete cell, then you are doomed. Because you lose one, then you cannot function. So to do so, each different homologous chromosome will line up in the early stage of a cell division for producing this gamete. Okay. We are going to take a look at it once again in later on, in the later chapter, but to increase the understanding of this Y recombination here. So between these two homologous chromosomes, before the cell actually split, so here, one chromosome, why they are in like in two doublet, because they went through the chromosome duplication, like cell the DNA replication before the cell division. That's why you normally they exist this singlet and cell chromosome duplication, it became this, and you have another homologous chromosome pair partner here, which undergone the same thing, so in existing in terms of the doublet instead of a singlet. So chromosome duplication first. Like this. Now, so this is the first stage, and then now second stage, they will split each of them. This one will go one room and another one will go the other room. Okay, but before they do that, there is a little event of shuffling, exchange, because these are the homologous chromosomes, which means at the same location, the type of gene existing are the same type of the gene, although little details could be different because they were originated from two different individuals, mother and father, but still. For example, like if the same area location there indicate one particular gene, and so is the same type of gene will be there at the corresponding location of this, the homologous chromosome. And then they will have this exchange, as you can see in this diagram, through like this crossing over event here, and later all of a sudden the result is some portion has migrated into the other homologous chromosome and vice versa. So this originally this part was here and then they have moved, so this exchange, reciprocal exchange, which means this mutual exchange of the small local segment of the DNA. That's what it is about, the crossing over. Although in this figure, this crossing over event appeared to take place only once, however, along with the entire length of a chromosome, this crossing over event occur so frequently. So actually this shuffling is happening in at a major scale. So anyway, this is what we call as a recombination. What I mean by this recombination, because the DNA sequence, as I said, the fine details of DNA sequence on one homologous chromosome could be different from the corresponding homologous chromosome of the other, the maternal origin and paternal origin of a chromosome. And then if you have this crossing over event, that result in the shuffling of DNA sequence. So you will have some kind of a difference, change in DNA sequence. So that is something that, which is contradicting to that previously I defined as a mutation as any sequence change. Yeah. So in other words, DNA sequence change, which arose, the thing other than mutation, we thought mutation is the only source of these DNA sequence change. So that's the actually principle by which we rely heavily on this DNA sequence comparison as a very reliable kind of a measuring stick to view some, to learn some evolutionary relationship among different individuals. But now we learn that although it is not actually too much a great extent, so it could be a little bit of negligible, but still there is some portion of this DNA sequence change coming from some other source, which is different from mutation happens in the case of this chromosomal DNA because of this crossing over event between the homologous chromosome. But then you realize that this is mitochondrial DNA because they are haploid, they don't have any homologous chromosome partner, so there is they don't have any such opportunity of having this crossing over, so no recombination. So Then their sequence variation, if you found any sequence variation in the one mitochondrial DNA in one individual, which is different from the other individual, those differences was strictly 100% can be guaranteed by coming from the mutation only. So that is actually, that will make this sequence comparison more accurate and reliable than those using the nuclear, the chromosome DNA. That's why. And also another advantage of using this mitochondrial DNA is, as I say briefly, well, not only a single copy of this mitochondrial DNA exists in one mitochondrion, but multiple, using multiple copies of exactly the same replica of multiple copies exist in a single mitochondrion. Besides, if you think about how many actually mitochondria usually exist in a single cell, several hundred, you can easily have several hundred mitochondria, each of which contain these multiple copies of DNA, which all adding up, you will be dealing with a huge amount, relatively high, much higher amount of this DNA. So if you actually are really concerned about sample availability, especially like if you had to get the DNA sample from already deceased fossil remains, then it should be obviously it's a huge advantage over trying to isolate chromosomal DNA from that individual. And another very obvious advantage is this mitochondria is always inherited from maternal lineage. If you imagine the shape of a sperm, they have a little space to carry their own mitochondria. Even if they do, once inside of the egg after the fertilization, those paternal origin of mitochondria are actively, intentionally destroyed. It's very amazing mechanism of ensuring this single origin of mitochondria in the cell. So only those you are a male like me, in every cell of me, inside of them, the mitochondria are the ones that come from my mom. So this inherited maternal origin, so this is what I'm saying. Okay, all this cytoplasmic content is coming from female egg. That's why. So it is very advantageous to, if you are only interested in particular sex of origin. So like this, so usually referred as a mitochondrial Eve project. So in Bible, Adam and Eve, referring this origin of a female. So by comparing the mitochondrial DNA, you can follow the female origin of humans. And it turned out that the result showed that actually all the existing females were the descent of only very handful of very small number of females, but then I'm talking about all those females living outside of the Africa, which means those who spread it all over the rest of the area of the earth are actually those who originated from very small number of several, like five or six different females in originally. Similarly, the reason why among the nuclear chromosomal DNA only this Y chromosome is used preferentially, so similarly speaking, although Y chromosome is a chromosomal DNA, it doesn't show any recombination, no crossing over, because the homologous chromosome pattern of Y chromosome is an X chromosome. X chromosome. And Y chromosome is like this. Hey, physically speaking, there's no similarity exist. And the majority of the area, the type of genes present on Y chromosome and the X chromosome, that the genes are totally different. We are not here talking about the same kind of genes, but only DNA sequences are a little bit. The type of gene, kind of gene that exists on the Y X chromosome is absolutely different from those little. To begin with, the kind of gene present on the X Y chromosome is very, very limited. That's only very small number of genes present. And they are not found in their partneric the X chromosome. So there's no way they can have this engaged in this crossing over business. Those crossing over only can occur between actually true homologous chromosome having bearing same type of, structurally speaking, same type of, and also the DNA sequence wise bearing many similar region. Okay. So no recombination, so they can have the same benefit of, like, if you have some DNA sequence difference in Y chromosome, that is truly kind of indicative of mutation only, so like increasing the reliability of this sequence comparison translated into the evolutionary lineage. And similarly also in the case of the mitochondrial DNA, it is the Y chromosome is always transmitted from father to son, okay, male to male. So it is kind of very suitable to trace the paternal origin of this. So this is the feature that I'm talking about in the case of a human. Some other animals like frogs, there is not much difference between Y and X chromosome, but like higher mammals like humans and any other related higher mammals, their X and Y chromosomes are this much different. Okay, so this the feature with this feature, it is ideal to trace paternal origin. So this is frequently referred as a Y chromosome Adam project. So with that, scientists have been able to look at the origin of this human, and it turned out that all these humans living outside of this Africa nowadays turned out to originate from Africa, all of them. Yeah. It's not something that some small group of human who did not originate from Africa, but they arose from locally on their own. No such human lineage have been found until now. So briefly speaking, this at first attempt Homo erectus, when the era of Homo erectus, the earlier human form, they attempted to migrate out of Africa, and then they settled in this Eurasia area. Approximately it's like 1 million years ago, but then it turned out that they all disappeared. They couldn't manage to adapt. So except for the Neanderthals, so later they develop, evolve into Neanderthals, and occupying some small area like some Europe and a small part of the Asia. So then everybody else got all extinct. That's what happened. And then second round of this migration attempt was made by another group of humans living in Africa more recently, like 150 or 200,000 years ago. And then this time they were able to succeed, and then they were to spread out to all over the world. Okay. So this, the newer event of migration, and all of this now became the ancestral form of the present day human living the outside of this Africa. And interestingly then, already in certain area like Europe, there have been already existing Neanderthals. So these newcomers, new migrants, and old Neanderthals must have coexisted for quite some time period. Okay, so during which then what happened to them? Were they fighting? Were they making friends with? We don't know actually. And also more mysteries. And then how come all of a sudden this Neanderthals in the middle of this coexistence? So in what occasion, what made this old Neanderthals disappear eventually? Was it Earth to physically actually drove out all those Neanderthals and then killed them off, or maybe some other inadaptability intrinsic to this Neanderthal? We don't know. This remains just a whole mystery. So if you compare the shape of Neanderthals and us, actually they were quite similar. And then in the case of the brain size, the cranial size, Neanderthals are slightly even much bigger, which indicates that they wouldn't be inferior in terms of their intellectual ability. They were probably as equal as those ability of us, and then that makes actually makes the disappearances more mysterious. And this, the blue area, indicates the overlapping area of where Neanderthals range, and obviously coexistence range also as well with the modern day human. And so DNA sequence comparison also determined that Neanderthals were not our direct ancestors, because if they the DNA sequence difference was if they were actually our own ancestor, like representing our kind of earlier form of a common ancestor, their sequence difference should have been more diverse, should have been greater. So that is not the case. And one interesting thing which was discovered after this project of the Neanderthal genome project, which was undertaken at the 2006 to 2010, I noticed that within only 4 years now it's been able to be completed by the renowned German Max Planck Institute. So turns out that the whole amount of genome was very similar to that of a human in that 3 billion base pair, of course, in the Neanderthal genome sequencing project. And the technical difficulty, if you imagine, this project would have been much more challenging, but despite this adversary, they were able to finish this in a shorter period of time. Because they had to get all those DNA from where? Where else? This bone, the fossil bones. So they had to extract those DNA from fossil bones. And here we are not talking about the mitochondrial DNA anymore. This Neanderthal genome project, we are talking about the entire the nuclear genome. So they had to gather probably, perhaps they must have gathered so much, a huge amount of these the samples. bone samples. And it turns out that the DNA sequence overall is the identity level was almost 98%, 99, almost 90, almost 100%, 99.7% identity between Neanderthals and human. Wow, this is, it is within the error range. So we are virtually this identical. By comparison, if you do this with chimpanzee, the next closest relative living nowadays is 98.8%, which is really amazingly, strikingly close. But in this case of Neanderthal humans, yes, it's as good as such like identical. And interbreeding, which means we exchanged our genes between, so that's why this scientific name sometimes it is recognized as a Homo sapiens sapiens versus Homo sapiens neanderthalensis, which indicate the history of interbreeding. So biologically speaking, we are between Neanderthals and humans within the same boundary of biological species definition. Okay, and this doesn't end with the Neanderthals. Other ancient form of other humans, like other group of humans discovered somewhere else, like Denisovans, which was originally found from some cave in Russia, I guess, and Homo floresiensis, the nicknamed hobbits. Maybe they were as the smaller statues humans, and the evidence of this interchange of gene also do show clearly among Neanderthals and humans, and humans and Denisovans and humans and hobbits. So greater than we originally expected, the scale of this gene exchange must have occurred in the past. And so as a consequence, we now represent the solely existing human being as a species. But then obviously we carry the legacy of those, in particular this much greater portion of this Neanderthal gene legacy we carry on in among different population of humans. Here the red portions are the area having this color, the in red color, indicate higher, relatively speaking, higher proportion of this Neanderthal gene lineage. The population living on those area is a carry, including this all those Asian area and the South American area, and compare with the other area of, and notice that this Africa, perhaps probably those individual in these days, the population and the African population would have higher gene diversity they will just represent, because all those population outside of this Africa originally came from small group of those migrants, whereas those who remained, those who decided to stay, perhaps in numbers must have been much larger than those migrants, is perhaps the reason why their DNA sequence variation is greater than those who the other area of Africa. And finally, about this Neanderthal genome project, their gene legacy? It turns out that those kind of genes among those DNA sequences, what kind of genes then we inherited from Neanderthals? So we looked at it, and then it turns out that depressingly, the genes causing the depression and genes responsible for causing the allergy response, or genes that have been identified as some kind of causing these heart attacks and diabetes and then addictions, etc. All these the undesirable genes, like defective genes, rather than turned out that they were the one that came from those guys, Neanderthals. So now we have a very good excuse, and whenever we have this type of they would pick up this disease, and it's not our fault and their fault that dumped those genes to us. And another way of looking at this is perhaps then one might actually want to say that, oh yeah, that's kind of this obvious, in that that's why all those Neanderthals had to extinct, because they were the one carry this all these inferior genes. It's like we are lucky in a sense that they didn't give us more genes, so that if that was the case, we would have suffered much more than this in present problem. So is this something that indicative of their inferiority, the inferior nature of their genes organization? And experts disagree on this type of thinking, in that just because those genes nowadays represent those defects, like all those disease-related genes, does not mean that they were the one actually functioning in the same way when the actual Neanderthals were living on that particular environment. Environment matters. Perhaps the most logical explanations for why those genes in today give us some problems like the depression and allergy and diabetes is because of this changed environment compared with those harsh environments that Neanderthals had to fight through, originally speaking. For example, allergy, for just one, taking one just example, take the allergy, for example, is that allergy is the overreactive, more sensitive defense response, immune response. So in these days, because of this, our present day immune system, it gives us actually a lot of serious problem many times. However, back then, if you had such a higher sensitive immune response, probably that might have been much more beneficial, even actually very critical in their survival. The only thing different nowadays is all those, we can take care of our other pathogens in many, many different ways, so that we do not need such a sensitive immune response system, which is actually which became more problematic. And similarly, all other defective genes we can try to relate in this way is probably more politically correct and also scientifically correct account for those genes that we inherited from Neanderthals, but in these days are something that represent the problem. Okay, so with that, we all finish all about this evolutionary aspect of the chemically speaking, and also the Darwinian evolution aspect too, and Next chapter, we will move into the small inside of the cell to have a journey of their structure and function, as in particular the eukaryotic cells.